Good evening. It's 8 o'clock. The top headlines tonight. Well, in a major step forward, India-China tanks pull back. Disengagement formally begins. The defense minister in parliament says India has conceded no land. India and China are now to move back in the Pangong area of Eastern Ladakh to pre-2020 positions. Rahul Gandhi in parliament says his government is hum do, hamare do. It's run by just four people. He says the new farm laws will lead to unemployment, poverty and suicides. Furor over Rahul Gandhi's speech in parliament. Battleground Bengal, Amit Shah versus Mamata Banerjee. Amit Shah says we will bring the new citizenship laws as soon as vaccinations are completed. Mamata Banerjee hits back saying don't take on Didi. New draft rules for social media and OTT platforms. Government oversight is now planned of the social media, news websites and Amazon, Netflix, etc. Trinamool MP Mawa Moitra's speech on cowardice and courage goes viral, but she faces two privilege notices. She says won't be bullied into silence. Our lead story tonight. Well, India and China have formally begun the disengagement process in the Pangong area. With tanks of both sides moving back, they are now moving back to pre-April 2020 positions. Speaking in Parliament, the Defence Minister said India has not conceded an inch of Indian territory.
Chinese Type 96 tanks moving away from a face-off site on the south bank of the Pangong Lake. Moments later, an Indian T-72 tank is shown turning away. The end of a dangerous face-off in an area where the armies of India and China have come close to clashing. The disengagement process, India says, has not come at any cost to the Indian Army.
I want to assure you that we have not lost anything in this conversation, Sabhapati Mahoday. I want to give this knowledge to the Sadan. यलेची पर डिप्लॉयमेंट तथा पेट्रोलिंग के बारे में कुछ आउटस्टैंडिंग इश्यूज बचे हुए हैं इन पर हमारा ध्यान आगे की बातचीत में रहेगा
जो भी निर्णय आदि दोनों पक्षों द्वारा अप्रैल 2020 से नॉर्थ एंड साउथ बैंक पर किया गया है उन्हें हटा दिया जाएगा और पुरानी स्थिति बना दी जाएगी
As part of the disengagement process announced first by the Chinese government yesterday, Chinese soldiers will move beyond Finger Eight on the north bank of Pangong Lake. Indian soldiers will move to their existing base on Finger 3. The area in between will be a no man's land where there will be no patrolling by either side. There will be similar moves on the south bank of Pangong. All structures built by both sides after April 2020 on both banks of the lake will be removed.
While the disengagement along Pangong is crucial, there is still no clarity on when Indian and Chinese forces will move away from each other in other parts of eastern Ladakh. This includes the Debsang Plains to the north and also the Hot Springs area. And there's still no final agreement on the status of the area between Finger 4 and Finger 8 on the north bank of Pangong, which continues to be claimed by both sides. Vishnu Shom for NDTV.
So a major breakthrough there. Meanwhile, in Parliament, furor during Congress leader Rahul Gandhi's speech as part of the budget discussion where he took on the Prime Minister and said that this government is all about hum do, hamare do, a reference apparently to top corporates, though he didn't name anybody. The Parliamentary Affairs Minister said he was referring to the Ambanis and Adanis, which created another furor. Also, Rahul Gandhi said he would focus only on farm laws and not the budget because he feels that these are the key issues currently facing India. He also asked all MPs to stand in two-minute silence, remembering farmers who had lost their lives in the protest. The speaker interrupted and said, "That's my prerogative."
आज इस देश को चार लोग चलाते हैं, हम दो और हमारे दो. जब ये कानून लागू होंगे, तो जो इस देश के किसान हैं, छोटे व्यापारी हैं. इनका धंधा बंद हो जाएगा सिर्फ दो लोग हम और हमारे हम दो और हमारे दो इस देश को चलाएंगे ये काम प्रधानमंत्री ने हम दो हमारे दो के लिए पहले नोटबंदी में शुरू किया था पहली चोट नोटबंदी थी
मुझे तो लगा था कोई वरिष्ठ सदस्य मुझसे पहले बोल रहे हैं उसको सदन की रूल्स की जानकारी भी होगी और ये भी पता होगा कि जब एक एक विषय पर चर्चा पहले हो जाए इस बजट पर, यानी कि उस विषय पर दोबारा चर्चा वापस नहीं होती है। मैं समझ सकता हूं कि बजट पर उनकी तैयारी नहीं थी, ना वो बजट के समय पूरे समय उपस्थित थे।
आप बजट पर चर्चा करें
ना, बाकी सदन में रहने की आदत है सर।
Well, moving on from Parliament to what's background Bengal, with the Home Minister Amit Shah today addressing a rally there, Mamata Banerjee also addressing daily rallies. Amit Shah has said that he promises that the new citizenship rules will be brought in after vaccinations are done. He also attacked Mamata Banerjee for not saying Jai Shri Ram. He said, if you don't say it in Bengal, will you say it in Pakistan? Mamata Banerjee hit back on this and also issues of being attacked over her nephew, saying, what about Amit Shah's family?
जो कहते हैं वो करते हैं। हमने सीएए का कानून पारित किया है। मैं आज इस पवित्र भूमि पर वादा कर जाता हूं, जैसे ही ये वैक्सीनेशन का काम समाप्त होता है, जैसे ही कोरोना से मुक्ति मिलती है, आप सभी को नागरिकता देने का काम भारतीय जनता पार्टी की सरकार समाप्त।
ये बंगाल के अंदर माहौल ऐसा कर दिया, जय श्री राम बोलना माने गुनाह है। मैं आपको वादा कराता हूं, चुनाव समाप्त होते तो ममता दीदी भी जय श्री राम बोलती हो जाएगी, आप चिंता मत करिए।
कलर का क्या, हम लोग बहुत खराब है ना बंगाल में है, आप कलर का क्या, इतना रुपया कहां से आया, पहले ए रिप्लाई दो। दीदी ऐसे बहुत अच्छा है, सच्चा बात करेगा, लेकिन दीदी को टकराएगा तो चूर चूर हो जाएगा।
Well, our special newsmaker on 8 o'clock tonight, a speech by Trinamool MP Mawa Moitra has gone viral this week in the Lok Sabha, where she talks about cowardice and courage. Let's just look at key highlights. Mawa Moitra joins us right after that.
The courage to use the official channels of the Ministry of External Affairs to respond to social media posts by an 18-year-old climate activist and an American pop star, where not even one single ministry has been deputed by this government to try and look out for the food, water and basic sanitation needs of the farmers and their families who have been camping at the border for almost 90 days. And finally, the courage to bring in 3 farm laws when the opposition, farmers across the country, as well as the government's oldest ally, warned it was unacceptable. These laws were arrived at without consensus, tabled without scrutiny, and rammed down this nation's throat with the brute force of the treasury benches. They have firmly established this government's motto of brutality over morality. And everyone else in this country has been portrayed as a coward or a terrorist, from the farmers to the students to the old ladies of Shaheen Bagh. You say you have courage. You claim you have done so many things that no other government before you has done. Yes, that is true. In true fascist fashion, you have made every act of pettiness, of vengeance, of hate, of bigotry, a part of your narrative of courage. The reason no one has done it before you is not because no one had the courage, but simply because it was not the right thing to do. There is a fundamental difference between cowardice and courage. The coward is brave only when armed with power and authority. The truly courageous can fight even when unarmed. Do not forget this. In the 125th year of Subhash Chandra Bose's birth, the central government has made every attempt to hijack Netaji's legacy and weave it into their own fake, narrow narrative of courage. But this nation needs to know that Netaji had 2 clarion calls, both embodiments of his courage and his spirit. One was the salutation, Jai Hind. Today, this government has replaced this national greeting with a narrow religious chant that it uses as a war cry to heckle, to bully and to always, always remind the minority about who's in charge. Netaji's second call was Dilli Chalo, Chalo Dilli. This government falls over itself to pay lip service to Netaji, but in truth, you block the borders in Singhu, in Ghazipur, in Tikri with walls and spikes for all those who actually want to come to Dilli to tell you that, much like Subhash Chandra Bose, they too will not accept any halfway house. Netaji told us never to lose faith in the destiny of India, and it is not India's destiny to be ruled by cowards. The time has come for us
please
all to show courage.
Please conclude.
Girte hai sehsawar maidan e jang mein. Wo tipl kya gire jo ghutton ke bal chale? Repeal or nothing. Thank you.
Well, joining us now tonight is Mahua Moitra of the Trinamool Congress. Mahua, I wanted to go beyond just politics and look at the themes you've chosen in this, cowardice and courage. Now, it's a speech that has gone viral. You've got lots of feedback on it, but you're also now facing two privilege notices, and you're saying that you won't be bullied into silence, that you do have a certain privilege as Lok Sabha MP. What do you mean by that?
Look, the law is very clear on this. This is typical BJP tactics, Sonia. It's typical if you can't get them with the CBI and you can't get them with the ED, they try every dirty trick in the book. If you remember my first speech way back in June in 2019, they first didn't catch on that it would become viral or that people would identify with my words. In a couple of days' time, when they found that people did and it resonated with all of India, immediately they set one of their pet media channels to come out with this entire plagiarism rubbish, right? So similarly with this speech, I think it hit home hard. And in about 48 hours, they kind of understood that a lot of people are resonating with this speech. So their spin factories, their propaganda machine, their dirty tricks department were absolutely, you know, up to the game. And what they've done is two members put in a notice of privilege. Now, let me be very clear. They quote Article 121. Article 121 is very clear that in the Lok Sabha or in the Rajya Sabha, you cannot discuss anything related to the conduct of a sitting judge of the High Court or the Supreme Court during the discharge of his duties. Right. What I said was in complete public domain. This particular gentleman in question is not a sitting judge. He's an ex-chief justice of the High Court or the Supreme Court. He has absolutely no constitutional protection whatsoever. And the second thing is, as far as I know, the Constitution of India does not define sexual harassment as discharge of duties of a judge of the Supreme Court of India.
Right. So I'm going to leave that because at the moment, of course, those remarks have been expunged. But let me just
I have not received anything that they have been expunged. And if you look at the Lok Sabha website, it is still available for everyone to see. So right. I'm not even sure they have been expunged. I, for one, have not been given any notice that they have been expunged, as they should not be, because I have not violated any rule either of the parliamentary procedure or of the Constitution.
I actually want to pick up on what you were saying on the two themes that you picked up. We talked about the cowardice and courage, and you talked about the use of state government machinery. Now, across the board, now we've seen this. This happens whether it's in chief ministers, whether it's in states. This is not only to the BJP. We've seen it happening in various states. The Trinamool also has been attacked for it. And now we're seeing a very heated battle between the Home Minister, Mr. Amit Shah, today in West Bengal, and Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee, where the charges being traded are all about this Jai Shri Ram, your son, my nephew, issues which in a sense don't seem to be what the people of India, the voters of West Bengal, are really concerned about.
Well, that's what the BJP does in spades. If you notice, Parliament is on, Lok Sabha is on. The Honorable Home Minister of the country should be present in the Lok Sabha. What is he doing in an election rally in Bengal, sort of, you know, undermining the state government? Mr. Rajnath Singh, the defense minister, was talking about Chinese aggression and India's counter to it. Everyone is talking about whatever's happening at the borders and the state of law and order in this country. You have information coming out that the Bhim Karikoregaon riots, where people were incarcerated wrongly, that was based on planted information. Today, you have information that on the 26th of January, whatever happened and whatever Delhi police said was actually not what happened. All of these issues are coming up in Parliament. Is it not the duty of the Honorable Home Minister to be in Parliament at least for a few hours rather than go on some raving rant in Kuch Bihar and Bengal? I ask you, is that what he owes this country? His priorities are very clear, right?
Let me ask you what he said today in West Bengal. He said that if we don't say Jai Shri Ram in West Bengal, would we say it in Pakistan? And I will make sure that Mamata Banerjee also says Jai Shri Ram. Now, you referred in your speech to Netaji and saying that he would not have used a slogan like Jai Shri Ram, but Jai Hind. In the India of today, are you not worried that this will be seen as anti-national or anti-Hindu or actually backfire an election if you say this?
Let me tell you two things. I don't know what kind of a Hindu or what kind of an Indian Amit Shah is, but he's got Mamata Banerjee wrong and he's got the Trinamool Congress wrong. We will say what we want when we want. We don't need anyone coming and telling us. It's high time he got this message. And if I didn't give it loud and clear, I'm sure my chief minister did. Thank you.
So what would you say, Mahua, when you've seen the exodus of Trinamool MLAs ex-Trinamool ministers who've gone to the BJP. If the Trinamool is so sure of the ground beneath its feet, why is it that people are leaving in droves?
I want to correct you. Actually, no one's left in droves. We had a majority of 211 out of 294. Then we had people from the Congress join us. So we had a total of 217 MLAs. I was also an MLA in the West Bengal Assembly, the current one, before I became an MP. I think 7 or 8 MLAs have left. Now, when you have a majority of 217, and with every election, we are 10 years into a government, I think 30 to 40% of MLAs everywhere, everyone, there's a churn, and people get new faces. Now, remember, this is politics. Politics is like a chess game. There's only one space for one person. It's a zero-sum game. So when certain incumbent MLAs realize that perhaps the party is not going to nominate them again for that particular seat, they decide to look for greener pastures, and that's what they do. And this is politics. This is a churn that happens everywhere. I would stand with your statement of saying people left in droves if out of a majority of 211, 50 people has happened. Two ministers have left who probably won't even win in their own seats. I challenge both of them to try and get nominated on a BJP ticket from both of their current assembly segments. They will not win. Mm-hmm. So this is a parcel of politics. I mean, it's okay. You had Rao Birendra Singh, if I remember, he was a minister in the Congress government of defense procurement or something. Mm-hmm. And he switched over and stood on a BJP ticket and won from Gurgaon 2 days before and went on to become a minister in the BJP government. This is all part and parcel of politics. You know, this is nothing to sort of get alarmed about.
So coming back to, I think, what in your speech touched a chord was your definition of what you see as an India of today. When, amongst those various themes, you talked about migrant workers, you talked about reactions to social media posts and various issues of cowardice and courage. You mentioned, of course, farmers who are out there protesting, but who would you define? And let's not get into, say, people and personalities in this, but what would you look at as examples of cowardice and courage in today's India?
I think I'll give you a prime example. Today, I've said something. I don't think I have said something which is very, very brave or very courageous in the Lok Sabha. I think I'm a parliamentarian. It is my privilege that I have been elected in this great democracy of ours. People have chosen me. I'm there speaking my heart out. What I'm speaking is the truth and what I feel. It is my right to do so as an Indian and for the people I represent. Now, the problem that has happened is that imagine how low our bar for courage has fallen in this country, that very act of speaking the truth is seen as, you know, as the phrase goes, a revolutionary act. The standard of mediocrity that is prevalent everywhere in politics and society today makes even one spark seem like a flame. And I think my speech, I'm glad people liked it, but believe me, I have not said something that is revolutionary nor very courageous. I've just spoken the truth. Now, so in a world where cowardice is the norm, even that is a thing of courage. And I think that is what exemplifies it. The fact that what I would consider a very truthful from the heart speech of mine that I wrote has gone viral is that so many people are resonating with it because they can't seem to say this in an open platform. And it requires great courage in today's India, which is so filled with false bravado.
No, I think that's a key point. Just speaking the truth nowadays is seen as an act of courage. Thanks so much, Mawa, for joining me. It was great speaking to you. And as I said, congratulations on a very impassioned speech there. We'll, of course, see what happens with those privilege motions. But thank you very much for joining us on NDTV tonight. And perhaps referring to what Mawa was just saying, well, the government now has new draft rules, which will likely rein in social media and OTT platforms. The government's framed draft rules for social media OTT platforms, which will be, in a sense, much tougher for what the current issues are on it. Sunil actually takes us through that, because Sunil, I think one of the controversial bits on this would be the setting up of a government oversight, in a sense, and a chief compliance officer. Tell us the details.
That's right, Sonia. In fact, what they're attempting to do with these draft rules under the Information Technology Act of 2000 is to see one way or the other that there is some oversight mechanism. First of all, there's a code of ethics which the ministry will formulate. Then there'll be a self-regulation mechanism, and on over and above that, an oversight mechanism headed by an interministerial committee. Whom does it cover? It covers everybody possible, from Facebook to Twitter to Instagram to Netflix, Amazon, Amazon Prime, to anybody else. So it's in that context that the government of India, where there was no regulation earlier, mm-hmm. is now trying to have some control and ensure that there is some compliance. There has to be a chief compliance officer.
Right.
The ministry will have a grievance redressal mechanism, mm-hmm. as well as a portal for that. and they will have to comply. They will have to be a 24/7 compliance officer to work with law enforcement agencies. And if the government in an emergency situation deems fit, it can remove it immediately and then go back to the interministerial committee. So a lot of provisions have been made. These are, of course, fine.
That comes, of course, amid that raging fight currently between the government and Twitter. And as we end tonight, these pictures of a soldier while drumming have gone viral. Played against Sam, this young soldier called Sam K. Daniel seems to be just amazing on the drums. Listen to it.